When I was 15, I was invited to interview the head of the United States Environmental Protection Agency for National Public Radio. I worked for weeks on my questions, even though there was really only one thing I wanted to ask. Why is the United States still drilling for oil? My big day came. "We're not drilling for oil," he said. "We're exploring for energy. You like energy, don't you? You don't want to be cold this winter, do you? You don't want us relying on foreign oil, do you? The kind that starts wars?" That night, when I listened to the interview on the radio, my voice was the only thing I recognized. I was angry, frustrated, confused. How had he used my words in ways that I didn't understand? He created a world in which energy as we know it is necessary. As a result, I began to be interested not just in what we say, but how we say it. What is the difference? Drilling for oil, exploring for energy. No oil leaves a plethora of options, but no energy was going to leave me cold all winter. I want you for a moment to think of a dog. Whatever comes to your mind is going to reflect your experience with a dog. Perhaps you're afraid of them. It might have beastly eyes and teeth bared. Or you just adopted one from the shelter, and your heart melts every time it gives you that look that knows that you gave it its forever home. As scientists, we expect the world to transform our words into action. Yet, for those for whom the climate urgency is not within their worldview, this doesn't happen. Think back to that dog. Despite my intentions, not one of you thought of my dog. Why? When we're talking about something abstract, a dog you don't know, or what's going on with the climate, so much of which is outside of our tangible grasp, the words we use often let us down. Let's think about what we even call what's going on with our planet. In the 1980s, we spoke of global warming. In the 1990s, that began to be eclipsed by climate change. So I'll ask you, what is change? It's neutral. It can be good. It can be bad, but mostly it's passive. It happens to us. I'll ask you this. How do we respond to change? We respond to change by adapting, not mitigating. Here in the Northern Hemisphere, as November is rolling into December and it's colder, I put on a sweater. I don't stave off winter. The first thing we need to do if we want to address what's wrong with our planet is to name what's wrong with our planet. We cannot fix, we cannot fight climate change, but we can tackle a climate crisis. The term climate crisis began to be entered into our lexicon in the mid-2000s. Over the past 3 years, it has increased 20 times. We have other terms, climate emergency. 79 times it has increased in usage in that same time period. Climate chaos, threat multiplier, environmental destruction. Yet none of these terms have entered into our scientific and international discourse. Why? Is it because you are afraid of being alarmist? Or you're ashamed of the world that you have created? Climate crisis. Crisis captures the urgency, the chaos of what's going on, but it invites opportunity. It requires action. Last summer, the UN put out a statement, "Climate change is the greatest crisis of our lives." Framing crisis in a passive worldview over which we have no control. That doesn't work. Archbishop Desmond Tutu notably said that if one is neutral in the situations of injustice, one sides with the oppressor. So step up. Whether you're the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the United Nations Conference Climate Change wrapping up today, the first thing you need to do is change your name. Identify reality and name it. Replace change with crisis. Lead with agency and not passivity. Words matter. The oil companies know this. They look at us and say, why don't you calculate your carbon footprint? What are you doing to lower your emissions? They've stripped us with our humanity, not even calling us people anymore, but consumers. They say that we are driving a demand and they are just meeting it. They make us responsible through language. Early in my studies on language, I stumbled upon a book written in 1980 by George Lakoff and Mark Johnson, known as Metaphors We Live By. In this book, they explain that metaphors aren't just figures of speech, but roadmaps of cognition. They work by relating our existing knowledge with something else. We use metaphors all the time when talking about the climate crisis. Our house is on fire, our oceans are boiling. Somebody's asleep at the wheel. Metaphors are culturally and linguistically specific. In my country, USA, the most common metaphor we use when talking about the climate crisis is that of a journey. We're on the path to lower emissions, the race to zero. Here in Switzerland, we talk about illness. We need to heal a wounded planet. In Great Britain, where COP is wrapping up today, and indeed the prevailing metaphor for the climate around the world is that of war. On the surface, climate and war have a lot in common. Mass mobilization, that we're in it for the long haul. Reductions, restrictions. Yet for 40 years, we have been calling for this fight. We have called to join together. This is a victory, we can win. This is our battle. 40 years. September 1st, 1939, Germany invades Poland. Within 2 days, our entire planet knew we had started the Second Great War. 2 days. Why is this metaphor not working? Because when we talk about the climate crisis, we talk about war, it frames our thinking within that of conflict. Suddenly, we're talking about division, destruction, violence. These aren't themes we need to heal our planet. Who's our enemy? This becomes us versus them. Allies become our enemies. When juxtaposed against economic growth, even the planet itself can become a villain. For some, they use this metaphor to declare war on climate science. For others, it's against climate change. But here, climate change is a symptom. Fighting change is akin to giving a pain tablet for an otherwise aggressive yet treatable cancer. Our enemies, the oil companies, the blah, blah, blah politicians, the billionaires rocketing to space, all of capitalism, our entire consumer economy? How can we fight a war against so many opponents at once? And we fight wars to win, don't we? At what point do I get to pop my metaphorical champagne, throw my confetti, and have my parade? At what point? the oil companies, they also use this metaphor. One of them says, are you opposed to fracking? Because if so, you might be a terrorist. Relating the act of speaking up to a criminal act of war. Another, in its annual sustainability reports, says that it is working to combat rising emissions. It's using our language to be on our side, one of us, one of the good guys. How then can we use language to talk about what's going on? The problem is that too often we fall on overly simplistic language. We can talk about more holistic metaphors. That iceberg that sank the unsinkable ship, juggling, multiple organ failure. We can engage in discussion, have conversations, ask questions, those whys that from such a young age were educated out of us. But most important, whether you're the United Nations, whether you're part of the media, or just having dinner with your family, we need to name what is going on by what it is, because that creates our reality, gives us agency. What's going on is the climate crisis, and we need to call it that. Because until we do, these metaphors that we live by are going to be the metaphors that we die by.